What do you do when you're longing to work in your art journal but only have a little time? Today I'm going to show you small-sized journals that allow you to quickly complete a page or page spread. The journals may be small, but the enjoyment and satisfaction are full-sized. When I describe a journal as small, I'm typically thinking something along the size of what you see here. Now, obviously, size is relative, and if you've been working in a giant 11 by 14 inch journal, then one as large as 5.5 by 8.5 might feel small by comparison. But in general, I'm talking about smaller ones like this. This is 3.5 by 5.5, this is 5.5 square, and then this one is really cool because it's this very elongated landscape shape. It measures 3.5 by 8.25. So all of these are made by Global Art Materials, and they're all actually really, really nice. I picked up this one at a trade show a couple of years ago, and it's been hanging around, and I haven't done anything. And I realized that I've been doing many things other than art journaling, and so I thought, well, maybe I need to pick this up. The smaller size lends itself to completing a page or page spread much more easily and more quickly than working in my standard journal. I don't know, for me, standard generally means about 5.5 by 8.5 in either the portrait or the landscape orientation. So I went ahead and I started with this, and the first thing that I noticed, these are considered drawing journals, both this one and this black one here. And so the paper in them is not heavyweight, and you'll need to keep that in mind, and we're going to talk about that and how you can work around this. But as you'll see, you can do all kinds of fun things in here. I'm not at all limited because of this paper, and I want to show you how you can, because typically what's going to happen is you'll find a small journal like this and it may not have heavy paper in it. Now obviously Strathmore makes the visual journals, but they're ring bound or spiral bound, and I'm not always a big fan of working in them. I like regular bound journals like this. So coming back to this, these are both what they call their buff drawing paper, and then we have this one here, which is actually white watercolor paper. So you can get away with a little bit more here than you will in the others, but for the sake of argument, and I want to say this feels like it's about 90 pound watercolor paper, for the sake of argument, because I'm working small and I'm working on typically non-watercolor paper, I'm going to show you some techniques that you can use that are going to lend themselves to this kind of paper. I'm going to show you the first one with distress, and in fact, that's what I did here. And you're going to start, and I'm just going to quickly show you how I do this. You're going to start by putting a thin coat of gesso on both sides of the page spread. And I'm just going to lay paper towel underneath so that I can not get gesso on the next sets of pages. And the part of this that I'm deliberately trying for is casual and imperfect. The paint is going to attach differently depending on whether or not there's gesso on that page. And so this is going to allow me to get some coloration changes, some intensity changes with very little effort, because the paint's going to grab differently where the gesso is and where it's not. So if you put on a really thin coat like this, it's going to take no time at all to dry. And so I'm just going to put this to one side. I've already got one prepped and ready to go, but first I need to wipe that up before it gets in places where it doesn't belong. So we'll just slide that out of the way, pick up the excess, and let me bring in what I've already got started here. All right. So I've already prepped, and now that we're done, I can actually take this off. Now all of these journals have this elastic closure. They come with, or at least the drawing journals, come with this page marker. Honestly, I pulled it out of the small one, and I can't pull it out of this one, so I'll end up having to cut it out. Now I've already gone ahead and gessoed these two pages, and so I'm going to start here. I'm going to use distress. I'm going to give them a shake. I'm going to use four colors of distress, and I'm just going to orient this back toward me. And then I'm going to just apply it with my fingers, and whoops, you'll see how easy this is and how nice it is. So I have twisted citron, cracked pistachio, peacock feathers, and then I'm going to use a little bit of picked raspberry kind of as a highlight color. So I'm just going to put a little bit of that out over here. Again, I've got gesso here. Let me just grab, I don't have a scratch paper around, so let me just put this under here like this, so I kind of keep the stuff contained. And I like to start with the lightest color, which for this is more or less the twisted citron. And what you'll notice is because these pages have been gessoed, you're going to see the paint slip a lot more than it ordinarily would if you were just applying it on a page that hadn't been prepared. And that's the point of the gesso. Now you can see right there, the paint is a little bit different color. That's because I missed when I hit this spread, rather, with the gesso. I can't talk today. All right, so let's just slide this under here. What I like to do, Distress has a little bit longer open time than many paints, and so what I like to do is really rub this and spread this with my fingers so that it does not take a long time to dry. And with the Twisted Citron done, I'm going to come back, do the same thing with the Cracked Pistachio, and just kind of work my way across both pages of this spread. You do not have to cover every last inch of this spread. If you want to leave some white space, that's great too. Or you can leave some that's a little lighter. And the harder you rub and the more you spread this, the colors will tend to lighten. Even though Peacock Feathers is considerably darker than the other colors, I can affect how dark it is or isn't by really pushing to rub that color around and spread it into a thin layer. Oops. Again, you can see the areas where I missed with the gesso. That's not a mistake. That's a happy accident that allows me some nice texture. All right, so I think this is close to enough coverage. Again, I don't feel like I have to have every last bit covered with paint. I'm just kind of knocking the excess off of my finger here. That might have been a little bit too much, but I'll spread it out. And now what I'm going to do is come back with a little bit of the Picked Raspberry and just add it as a highlight here and there. Because the Distress is going to dry and be permanent when it is dry, I can layer this right over that green without any difficulty at all, which is really nice. And I can just kind of sneak a little pink into various places on here, very simply and easily. So this is the first technique. This is gessoing the page first and then coming back and applying a little bit of Distress paint with your fingers. If you find yourself without the time or perhaps the patience to apply that initial coat of gesso and let it dry, then you'll find this technique even quicker. What I'm going to do is apply thin layers of paint, and I've chosen four colors of dilutions, and then I picked up Abandoned Coral in the Distress line. The point I'm making is that you can do this with either of these paints. It works perfectly well, and I'm going to use the mini ink blending tools, and this is how I'm going to get color on the page quickly and in a really thin layer so that it's dry very quickly. So again, I'm just going to slide some paper underneath these pages to keep the paint off the adjoining ones. And then it's really just a matter of, and I like to do this with one per color. You can see that I've got some already with color on them and some are new. You can take these at the end of your work session and rinse them in water and reuse them, or you can just toss them. Sometimes if I leave them just standing like this with the paint side down on my nonstick craft sheet, they're good till the next day, so you don't actually have to wash them every single time. Once again, I'm going to start with the lightest color, and what I want to do is just go ahead and get some paint on the mini ink blending tool. Now, I don't want a ton because, again, my goal is brevity, to get the color on and to have it to dry. So I'm just going to start applying the color in a circular motion in various places on the page spread. All right, that's probably enough yellow. Let me come in with a little bit of the squeezed orange. At the end of the day, when I get the squeezed orange on this page spread, I'm not certain how much of a difference is going to be between that and the Abandoned Coral, but I figured I would try them both and we'll see how it looks. Again, you see this is really quick. Let's get these out of the way. Let's come back with a little bit of Abandoned Coral. Pick up another one of these. Ah, there is quite a difference, so that works really well too. I don't worry about the marks that I'm getting from the mini ink blending tool, primarily because there are going to be lots of layers on top of this. If I come back to this initial spread, this was done with the paint over gesso, but nevertheless, if I come back to this, you can see there's a lot of other things going on. This one was done with the same technique that I'm showing you now with the ink blending tool. Again, all of the marks disappear into the background, and quite honestly, they provide texture, so it's not a big deal one way or the other. All right, that's enough of that. Let's do that with the pink. Let's do some red with this. Now, this is pretty strong red, so I don't want to overload this tool. Oops. All right, next up is going to be the pink, which is going to be kind of my kicker color and the one I would like to see the most of. Now, I did just put that where I had blended something previously, but really, it does not make a darn bit of difference. If I think I took too much of the yellow out, I can come back and add a little bit more here over the top just to emphasize the yellow a little bit. And Bob's your uncle, it's done. I mean, it can be that quick. And then once you get to this point, then it's a question of coming back and adding other things. We're going to talk about various layers, but at the end of the day, you could probably complete one of these spreads, or at least the background on one of these spreads, in 15 or 20 minutes tops. This is virtually dry. It doesn't require any drying time, and that's what's so really nice about both this technique and this one here, wherever it is, where you apply it with your fingers. It's done so quickly that you can just jump right into the next steps. With the backgrounds complete, for me the next step is to add some additional layers. I want pattern and color and texture. Now obviously those are an intermediary step. My ultimate goal is to get some stamped images on here like I've done on these two pages. But my next step has to be to get all this other stuff that's on here going on. I mean, I like this, but I think, for my purposes at least, I find this far more attractive when I look at a finished page spread. So this is where I want to go next. Now your options to do this are pretty much wide open. Stencils with paint or spray, you can spatter, you can dribble, you can stamp with black ink or not. And I'm going to show you a little bit of all of those things. So I'm going to start with the spray because I want to put that to one side and let it dry while we work on the other things. Now the most important thing, especially when you're working in a small journal like this, is scale. If you have an element that's too big, it's going to look a little odd. Now, for example, these are two of Tim Holtz's layering stencils. I think the size of both of these, even though this element is larger, the pieces in it are small, and so I think that either of these would be great. This is our Loris Ipsum stencil. This is just nonsense Latin text, and you can see that I've given you text in three different sizes. And while this might be a little bit too chunky, either this or the smaller size would work particularly well, so that's a possibility. So again, it's about scale, regardless of what you're doing, whether it's stamping or stencils. So I've picked up some of our background noise stencils. This is a nonsense Latin text stamp that's very tiny. I could use any of the scribble flowers, except perhaps number 3, which is a little bit chunky. This was probably okay for the 5x5. I'm not certain it would be great on the smaller ones, but you just never know. It's until you start playing with it, you don't know. So I'm going to grab, since I'm so fond of this, I'm going to grab this stencil, whose name I can't remember, of course, but it is from the newest release, Cyclone, that's what it's called, and I'm going to spritz through this. So I'm going to grab some paper, just so that I can control the overspray a little bit. Now what I'm going to do is not necessarily spritz the entire page spread. I'm going to spritz part of it, and then I'm going to flip this over and print. Now you all know that I'm very fond of all things bright and glimmery, so I'm going to choose one of the Lindy's Starburst sprays for this. I think I'm going to go with Delphinium Turquoise. There's going to be good contrast between this and the background, but it picks up on some of that peacock feathers paint that I used. So I'm going to just give this a shake. Now you can see I got some overspray here. I'm not worried about that at all. Just grab a piece of paper towel and kind of print this. And there you go. Now it's picked up on, you can see that there's leftover colors on here, and some of that has picked up a little bit. I don't have to have perfect coverage, and in fact I really don't want perfect coverage because then it looks too perfect. So let's slide this out of the way for a second and let that dry off. Now obviously if you want to get this done, because we talked about the fact that we need to do these in short periods of time, if that's what we're aiming for, then you might speed that up with a heat tool. But for now, I'm just going to bring in the next piece. And what I think I'm going to do is grab, let's use this nonsense Latin text, and I'm going to use just a very light coating of black ink. Black is going to be very dark against here, but rather than ink it like this, I'm just going to swipe really lightly, and that's going to put just a little bit of ink on there that's going to allow me to put just a little bit of pattern down without it being really, really dark. I'm happy with that. Again, it's just a question of layers building into something really interesting and exciting. The initial layer itself, or the groups of layers, are probably going, excuse me, the initial layer is not going to do it by itself, but as you get these groups together, you will. All right, so I'm going to bring in, this is the Loris Ipsum stencil, and I think I'm going to use the smaller size text because this is a 3.5 by 5.5 journal, and I'm going to bring back in the Dilutions bubblegum pink paint. So I just need to find my ink blending tool that has that color on it. I'm going to pick up a little bit. Again, I don't want to overload this. And just rub this through the stencil. And I'm going to get a little bit of texture this way. Again, this is not rocket science. It doesn't have to be. All you want to do is just add some texture. If you think you want to come back, for example, if I want to grab some Postbox Red, which I didn't even use in here, but it would make a nice accent color, I just need to find the tool that I use the Postbox Red with. And then, where am I here? I can come back over where I was and add some Postbox Red and kind of stretch that out a little bit. So, you know, there's lots of ways that you can add pattern and texture. Now, I just went and used the larger version up here. I don't think it makes a darn bit of difference. I'm not worried about it one way or the other. It's just about adding groups of layers that ultimately add up to a pleasing background. So that's good to go. Now again, because I'm working in such light layers, this is ready to move on to the next thing. And again, brevity is what we're aiming for here. And so this is good. We want to be able to move along without having to wait too much because again, if you're working small, chances are you don't have a lot of time. So with that said, I think what I'm going to do is a little bit of spattering. And with that in mind, I'm going to bring in some of the De La Rowney, the F&W Pearlescent Inks. This is Hot Mama Red. I think it's going to be a great contrast to this. I'll put a little bit out on my nonstick craft sheet. Off to the side, I have a container of clean water. And this is my spatter of choice tool. It is just a fan brush, so I'm going to wet it. I want to thin this out a little bit. Now, I will tell you, spattering goes everywhere. So I'm going to move this just to try to contain the spatters to the areas where I want it to be. And by tapping my finger on this, it allows me to get some drops to fall onto this page spread. So I'm going to need to take a second to dry this, and I will do that, and I'll come back, and then we can talk about some additional steps that you can take. Smaller journals with lighter weight pages mean we need to be mindful about how much liquid we put on there, but that doesn't mean you can't get great results. I mean, you saw me do this a few minutes ago. Now, obviously, this is a very interim step. It needs a lot more, but you can see that this spread has moved along quite a bit further. I've come in and I've stamped with that tiny Latin text, and I've used two different stencils on here. The first one is our Trax stencil, and what I did, because I wanted to get some contrast in the way the pattern went, was I spritzed with the Trax running one way, and then I spritzed again, and then when I went to print, I made certain that I flipped it 180 degrees so that the print of the Trax was going in the other direction. You also notice that my stencils are not clean. I don't mind that. It means that some of the time, I'm going to pick up a previous color that might not actually coordinate, but again, pattern and texture is all I'm looking to accomplish. I don't need perfection, not by a long shot. So with that in mind, let's just bring in the smaller version for a second. And you can see that first of all, everything is upside down on this page because I wasn't paying attention. So the text is oriented toward you, but now the journal is actually oriented toward me. At the end of the day, I don't care, and I can cover enough of this up with subsequent layers that it's not going to matter. So this is some leftover spray. This is a Lindy's, it's called Magnolia Magenta Gold. I'm just going to print it on here. Now this is black paint, so it's not going to come off. It's already dried on there. But I'm just going to print this, and again, eventually I'll cover up all of that text that's going in the wrong direction. So let's put that to one side and let it dry, and bring this one back in for a moment. Now, in addition to spattering with the F&W Pearlescent Inks, you can also stamp with them. At first glance, it might not seem the most intuitive thing, but it actually works pretty well. I'm going to use, this is platinum pink, I think. I want to use a lighter color so that there's enough contrast. Again, all I want to do is create lots of little layers. It makes for an interesting page when you do this. I'm going to pick up, this is our background noise dots stamp. So I'm just going to spread this out with my finger. Again, this is a technique that's not going to get you perfect impressions. It's just going to get you some texture and some layers, and that's my goal. And you can see, let me turn this so the light catches it, you can see that it's on here. Now with the pearlescent inks, I'm not just getting color, I'm also getting the glimmer, which appeals to me certainly, and I know that it does to a lot of you as well. And so this is an opportunity to add some interesting color and pattern. Now if I wanted to come back, I could spatter this with another color if I wanted. I could put more of this on here. I guess the larger point is that there's lots of different ways to achieve pattern and texture, and stamping with the F&W pearlescent inks is certainly one way to do that. So I'm going to come back, I'm going to finish all of these spreads, I'm going to get all the layers on there, and then we can come back and talk about the things that you do. Let's just bring this back in. The things that you can do, orient it toward you, with various stamps to create little page spreads, whether they have something to say or they're just pretty pictures. I tend to think of my pages as not ready for the final step, which is, for me, adding figures or houses or there's some focal element, some thing happening here. I don't think they're ready when they look like this. I think they're ready when they have some white dots on them. That kind of has become my trademark thing. And I like to use different sizes. Now, we talked earlier about scale and proportion, and at first blush, you might think that these large circles are really too big for this 3.5 by 5.5 journal, but I find them not to be. If I come back here to the beginning, you can see that I've used almost a full one, or in fact here a full one, and it's sitting under this house, and I think it looks just fine. Here I kind of used outlines a little bit more, but again, there's some white circles on there, which makes me happy. Now, there's a couple of different ways to do this, and we'll start with a dotted grid stencil. You can either grab some paint, some white paint, and you can put it through the opening with your finger if you want. Let's just put a little bit in the cover there. Kind of like this. And sometimes you'll see fingerprints in it depending on exactly what it is that you do. Or you can pick up your mini ink blending tool. Let me go ahead and grab some with some white paint here. Same process. You can do this either of these ways. I just generally find it easier to do with my fingers. These tend to make lighter dots. If you want a little bit more substantial, then you can certainly go ahead and do that. Now, in addition, again, coming back to scale, this is our Punchinella Quintet. These are the minis. These are 5 of the designs that appeared on the original 2 Punchinella Trio stencils, but I scaled them way down. So they actually are quite good for this as well. And this is one of the original Punchinella stencils. This is the number 1 stencil, and I tend to use this one quite a lot too. So any of these are going to work just fine on either of the, or any of these sizes of journals rather, and straightforward. There's not a lot going on here. It's not rocket science. You just want to add some dots, and when these dry, let me tip this up a little bit. When these dry, you can see them up here. I might come back with a pen and just kind of very lazily and haphazardly, that was the word I was looking for, very lazily and haphazardly just kind of circle around them, and I think that they look great like that. So once that's done, and let's come back over here, I'm going to finish a spread in the 5x5 size because that's the one I've got closest to the end. So my circles are already done. What I want to do is I can come back with a Pitt pen and I can do some very loose outlines around them if I want, like this. And sometimes I do them kind of scribbly, and this pen is already unhappy because I managed to drag it through white paint. This is not totally dry. Let's see if I can get one that's a little bit happier to work with me here. Ah, there we go. That's better. And you can see, again, just very loose circles here. Doesn't have to be anything fantastic. Sometimes I like to, I'm not going to do it yet, but sometimes I will come along, and I can do it on the side here. I'll just kind of put a sketchy border on. Now, the reason I'm not wanting to do it around the top is because I want to bring in some of our leaf stamps. This is the leaf number 1, this is the leaf number 2, and if I bring that small journal back, you can see that I've used the leaf number 2 here, and then I use this as leaf number 1, just to add a little bit of foliage at the top. So whichever you want to use, I'm going to grab number 2, because I like that one a little bit better today, I guess, and I'm going to turn this toward me. And all I want to do is make it look like there are some leaves hanging into the scene here. Now, didn't get a perfect impression there, but it really doesn't make any difference. All I need to do is come back with a Pitt pen. So if I want to, let's ink this all the way. If I want to come down and do this, I can get some groupings of leaves going on here, just like that. I probably would put one maybe along the side here like this. And then maybe let's get something I can, so I don't stamp on the inside of this cover if I come along like this, I can maybe put one, well, let's see, like this, and then maybe a small piece just like that. And I think that looks great. It just adds a little bit to the top of the page, and then if you want to, you come back around with your pen, and again, I can fix this where it's not perfectly done there. It's pretty easy to do, no big deal. And then I can come back and I can, again, this is not a happy pen, but I can come back and I can add kind of a scratchy border in here. And then from here, the question becomes, well, what do you want on your pages? And the answer is pretty much anything. So again, coming back, you can use, these are some Stampatique images. Oops, let's back up here. These are our wonky houses. There's 7 of them now. I want to say this is 6 and this is 5. I've got some of them started here. If I wanted to go ahead and put them on this page layout here. So you can see that there's lots of different ways that you can embellish these. And then what I like to do is come back. This is the Ideology Big Chat. And then this is the Ideology Chit Chat. And then this is the Ideology Small Talk that actually has sayings in it. And again, coming back here to the first piece I worked on, you can see that I've taken one of these long sentences and I just cut it up into bits. And then I did the kind of scratchy outline thing around it. Here, I used some of the Big Chat and did the same thing. So how you choose to finish your pages, whatever they end up being, they could be anything. You can see that you can make them very simple if you want just by doing something like this. But at the end of the day, these small size journals are really great when you don't have a lot of time or when you need to feel the satisfaction of finishing a project.